Hello everyone, my name is Sophia Baum. I use she, her pronouns, and I'm a youth ecology coordinator for Wild Diversity. Today, we're gonna go over plant identification. Let's go. So my interest in plant identification really came from a study abroad program I did to Palau, which is an island nation in Micronesia. So it's on the western side of the Pacific, close to the Philippines and Guam. While I was there for a two-week natural resource management course, so we learned a ton about the connection between the land and the water, the self-sustaining practices, the traditional ecological knowledge that was passed on. I was with, as my faculty leads, a botanist and a marine biologist, and so I had tons of questions, similar actually to the questions that I had as a child about how things serve the ecosystem, how they interact, what the purpose of them is, what the origin of them is, and I was able to get a lot of my questions answered. And so from them, or from that experience, I was able to come back to Oregon with a completely new lens and a completely new appreciation for the temperate rainforest that we do live in, or the Pacific Northwest. While also a student at Oregon State University, I was able to engage with the Alternative Break Program, which led me to experiences and relationships with the Yakima Nation and also Warm Springs Reservation in Central Oregon. Yakima Nation is in Washington. And so through those experiences, I was actually able to learn a lot about traditional foods or first foods, specifically huckleberries, elk, salmon, celery root, chokecherries, all of those things, and actually in Yakima, or on the Yakima Nation, I was able to attend a longhouse service. And so in saying this, I think that there's a lot of value in connecting plant identification, not only like the scientific pieces of plant identification, which if we nerd out about, that's awesome, that's super cool, but also that there's like historical significance to a lot of the plant species that we have within our region. So in drawing correlations between my experience in Palau, at the Yakima Nation, and also Warm Springs, I, as an individual, am really just curious about what more there is to learn. How can I build my knowledge on species, plant or animal, we're focusing on plant today, within the Pacific Northwest? How can I be more knowledgeable about first foods or culturally significant plants that are in this region? How can I be more knowledgeable about plants that I may need to watch out for, such as poison oak? Things such as these, I believe, are very valuable, in addition to kind of just having some fun facts to be able to pull out of your back pocket while you're out on the trail, is always fun. And so these are things that we could just continue to build on. This is a very, very introductory plant identification video, so I'm just going to share with you the books that I'm utilizing, an app that I'm utilizing, and also share some alternative apps, and what I really, really enjoy out of plant identification itself. So for today, we have three books. These two are actually paired together. So we have Shrubs to Know in the Pacific Northwest Forest, as well as Trees to Know in Oregon. Lastly, we have Plants of the Pacific Northwest Coast. And I'll actually put links to these books, or links where you can find them, on this description below if you're interested in checking them out. One thing that I do want to draw our attention to is the phenomenal introduction of these books. Even though I'm not an experienced botanist, that is not my profession, I still have a little bit of interest, and so I think that these books actually provide a wealth of information to get us started, such as the difference between a common name, which is generally in the language of your nation. In the U.S. it is English, even though we do know that English is not the national language of the United States, but it is in English, and the scientific name, which is always in Latin. So for example, for the common name of a western larch, western is the species and larch is the genus. For the scientific name, it's going to be the genus and then the species, so it's the Larix occidentalis. You can find out, which I really actually appreciate in this specific one, the Plants of the Pacific Northwest Coast, the relationship between people and the natural environment. So this book talks about how there has been indigenous people in this region up to 10,000 to 14,000 years ago, after, closely after the retreat of the last glaciers. And it talks about the relationship of plants as food, as plants as medicines. It talks about all of these different things, specifically in the trees to know in Oregon. It talks about the difference between conifers and broadleaves, and it has beautiful illustrations that help us with our plant identification. It has beautiful different keys to let us narrow down what exactly it is that we're looking for. And so when and if you do get a plant identification book, I actually highly encourage you to go through the introduction and continue to reference the introduction if there are things that we miss, because those are very, very useful pieces of information.
So I have a Samsung Galaxy Note 8. Right now I have a photo pulled up on Google Photos. I'm just going to show you how I use Google Lens, which I find to be one of the easiest methods of plant identification, and it doesn't require me to necessarily do it in the moment, and I can always come back and identify later. But essentially I have this icon here, and so this will take me right to Google Lens. And so it'll pull up potential plant species. So I have a hydrangea or a phyllox. It will give me pictures to reference. If I want to find out more about the hydrangea, I can go to a Wikipedia page and or pull up more results. And so in pulling up more results, I can find out essentially anything that I want, where hydrangeas grow, what different types of varieties there are, their scientific name, anything that I want. And I'll put links in the description below offering reviews and a variety of other plant identification apps.
So here we have the Oregon white oak, or Quercus garryana. So the difference between the Oregon white oak and the California black oak is on the lobes of the leaves, they are rounded instead of pointed. The Oregon white oak can grow up to 80 feet tall, it has about a 3-foot diameter within its trunk, and it has a rounded crown. The fruit that it bears are acorns that have a shallow cap, and the acorns are about an inch long. So here we have the redwood sequoia. The redwood sequoia is one of my favorite trees of all time. So it has scale-like leaves, it has a reddish-brown, stringy and thick, I would say soft-to-the-touch bark that protects them from insects, fire, and disease. They can grow up to 300 feet tall, they can have a diameter of 30 feet, and they are some of the oldest trees among us. So here we have the Douglas fir. The Douglas fir is the most common tree and is also the state tree of Oregon. It can grow up to 250 feet tall, have a diameter of 10 feet, and it is really characterized by its pine cones, where the three brackets, or the three-pronged brackets, have been compared to mice. When I was a kid, I remember learning this legend of mice that went and dove into the pine cones, or dove into the Douglas fir. For hiding, and so it looks like the hind lanes and the hind legs and the tail of mice. Douglas fir forests are also home to a lot of different wildlife, such as cougar, bobcats, elk, deer, a wide variety of birds, and small mammals. So here we have a big leaf maple. This is characterized by their big leaves, which can be anywhere from 6 to 12 inches long, sometimes as big as 15 inches long. So it's actually the largest out of all of the world's variety of maples. So this tree can actually grow up to 100 feet tall, have a diameter of 4 feet, and it actually has double samaras, which when I was a kid I used to call them helicopters, but they're the seed pods that have like the extended wing that fly. So they have double samaras and also a fuzzy seed. So I've also been taking pictures of different flower species all throughout the summer, so I'm going to share some of those with you as they are not in season any longer. I'm just going to share their name, what region they grow in, and some fun facts.
Davidson's penstemon is a dense mat of shrubbery with evergreen leaves and purple to blue lavender tubular flowers that grow all along the west coast on rocky ledges and slabs at mid to high elevation. Bear grass can grow up to 5 feet tall in large clumps of tough, wiry, grass-like leaves. Its flowers are fragrant, white, tiny, and overall saucer-shaped. Bear grass is a common occurrence in the Olympic, Cascade, northern Sierra Nevada, and Rocky Mountains. Chicory is a perennial herb with milky juice from a deep taproot and edible leaves. Chicory is native to Europe, but can also be found in North America, China, and Australia. Purple vervain can grow up to 6 feet tall and spread 3 feet wide. It has fragrant flowers on terminal and auxiliary stems and is native to South America, specifically warm tropical areas but is common in the southeast and west coast of the United States. Mountain laurel is a relative of the rhododendron. It flowers in mid-June with pink and red in the interior. It doesn't grow beyond 3 feet, and it is native to eastern United States, specifically Maine to northern Florida and from Indiana to Louisiana.
Thank you so much for joining me today. I hope you learned a lot. If you have any tips, tricks, or advice for how to get better with plant identification or what the next steps are, please leave them in the comments below. Have a good one.